testing will start becoming dark. And oppositely, the guys who work in the night shifts, for example, and they are very little exposed to the sun. So you will see their color after 4 or 5 years becomes brighter, becomes lighter. And this is why, because little amount of the melanin, it is now released in their blood. So melanin is the hormone that stimulates the melanocyte, which produce the melanin, and melanin is responsible for the pigmentation of the skin of the body. And it has some secondary actions also. We see here, this is not the secondary action. Usually what happens when we are exposed to the sun for a long time and more MSH is released, so it actually causes the degeneration of the melanocyte in our skin. And there is another type of the cells, we call them the keratinocytes. So keratinocytes start getting damaged, and ultimately there is a damage to the DNA. And when the DNA is damaged, it causes the skin cancer. So the hypersecretion of the MSH ultimately causes the DNA damage to the cell that leads to the cancers of the skin. Number one cancer cause in the female in United States. Because they expose to the sun for hours and hours every day. Sun bath they are taking. And here, this is what I was telling you, that it decreases the appetite or the hunger. And this action is controlled by the hypothalamus. Leptin is also associated with it. Sometimes MSH is associated with the anti-inflammatory effect on the body. And in the animals, or in the human beings, like in the pigeon, in the birds, in all these animals, especially these eagles, the flying animals like the pigeon and the birds, so it controls their sexual behavior as well. So in the lower and lower type of the species, like in the aliens and the birds, the MSH is associated to control the sexual behavior of the birds especially. This is what I told you, that when we go to the sun has the UV light and the ultraviolet light. And this UV light is responsible for the production or the release of the MSH. And same thing, higher level of the MSH release is associated with the hyperpigmentation of the skin. This is the Addison disease is not a characteristic sign of the hyper release of the MSH. And then it comes the one of the major hormones of anterior in Greenland, it is the growth hormone. So, what is the function of the growth hormone? So, usually you see that the main function of the growth hormone is to increase the size of the tissues, muscles, and the bones of the body. And all this action is under the control of the protein synthesis. 50% protein synthesis is more in the male than the female due to the release of the growth hormone. So we say the growth hormone, its main action is the growth of the tissues of the body, the bones of the body, and all this is related with the increased protein metabolism. Don't go with this thing, RNA or DNA problems. And another function of the growth hormone, it is associated with the mobilization of the fat. So, this is a very important function of the growth hormone. It always reduces the fat content in the body. It increases the muscle content, but it decreases the fat content in our body. And another thing here, it decreases the utilization of the glucose. So what will happen? When the glucose is not utilized by the muscles or the cell, it goes to the blood, and blood glucose level start increasing. So we suffer with the hyperglycemia. So mainly you will say it is responsible for the growth of the muscles and the bones of the body. It is associated to decrease the level of the fat in our body, and it causes the hyperglycemia if it is released in more amount or inaccessible. And again, you see here how the secretion of the growth hormone is controlled. Oh yeah, this is another thing. Growth hormone release is not gradual. We usually, the hormones keep on releasing every minute and every moment, and by negative feedback mechanism, their secretion is controlled. Growth hormone release is different. Like for example, after 3 hours, all of a sudden, it is released in very large amount, and then in the next 3 hours, no release at all. So this is called the abrupt release of the growth hormone, or this is the burst of the growth hormone. So if you look at 24-hour cycle, like 8 o'clock in the morning, the growth hormone is released in large dose. And then in the next 3 hours, no release at all. And after 3 hours, again a huge amount of it is released and it comes in the blood. So this is not the persistent or the consistent time of the release. It is the release at the burst, release, stop for 3 hours, and again it is released. It is not the sustained release. And there are the physiological conditions that affect the release of growth hormone. Like for example, when we are sleeping, we are under highly stress condition, you are performing the exercise, and when the blood glucose is low, the amount of the release of the growth hormone, it is increased. So in the sleep, more growth hormone is released. Under tension, more growth hormone is released. Hypoglycemia, more growth hormone is released. You are doing the exercise, more growth hormone is released. Insulin like growth factor, you inject the insulin in the hormone. This is the control of the growth hormone. Growth hormone releasing hormone is the factor, comes from the hypothalamus, and it controls the release of the growth hormone. Now again, it comes to conditions. Hyper-release of the growth hormone and hyper-release of the growth hormone. So whenever the amount of the growth hormone is more in the body, we suffer with a condition, gigantism, and another condition, acromegaly. Gigantism is the condition observed in the children. So if in the children, amount of the growth hormone is more, the children suffer with the gigantism. And when this boy comes to the adult age, and amount of the growth hormone is more in the adult person, so this condition is called acromegaly. So gigantism is the disorder of the young boys, acromegaly is the disorder of the adult person. And what could be the symptoms here? So the symptoms here is that the body size becomes bigger. So boy is maybe, for example, 10 years old, and the skeleton is like 16 years old. So this is the gigantism in the baby. And when this disease comes to the adult life, the symptoms becomes more prominent. And when the symptoms becomes more prominent, so this is very obvious that the skeleton is enlarged, maybe more than 6 feet 8 inches. So 6 feet 4 inches is not the normal skeleton anywhere in the world. Usually if a guy who is tall, the skeleton is around 6 feet 2 inches. But if you see somebody 7 feet tall, so maybe he is the case of the acromegaly. So this is one symptom. Then we have to look at the facial expression. So the jaws and the face and the extremities, they are broader. So you will see the jaw is broader type. And you will see the extremities like these hands and the feet, they are also very enlarged. So these are the symptoms of the acromegaly. And suppose the release of the growth hormone is decreased in a person, so the condition is called the dwarfism. And dwarfism is most commonly observed in the boys. So when they come to the age of puberty and they go to the age of 20 years, for example, 20 years is the time after which there is no more increase. is in the height. So these boys, their height is not more than 4 feet. So this is the broadest, low release of the growth hormone. You see, this is a picture here, and you can see the signs and the symptoms of the then it comes the hormone prolactin. And functions of the prolactin in the male person are limited. But the action of the prolactin are more prominent in the female. And what we say, this is the hormone to produce the milk, or it is associated with the lactation in the female. So in, on one hand we say it is responsible for the development of the epithelial cells, it is responsible for the development of the mammary gland, and during the 5th month of the pregnancy, this hormone is associated with the formation of the milk in the female. And the function of this hormone is all the time under the control of the prolactin-releasing hormone. Prolactin-releasing hormone is again divided into two types. One is called the prolactin inhibitory or releasing hormone. Other is called prolactin stimulatory releasing hormone. Now suppose, for example, a female is pregnant and she is in the 5th or the 6th month of the pregnancy, the milk is producing and it is stored in the alveoli of the breast, but it never comes out. Why? Because the prolactin inhibitory hormone is controlling the release of the milk. So inhibitory or inhibitory releasing factor, it never allows the milk to come out. And once the baby starts eating the nipple, the stimulatory releasing factor is now released and it sent a message to the alveoli to compress in the presence of the vasopressin, and the milk start coming out. So this is the reason why a female is not prepared for the neck, even after the birth of the baby, it is not that all the time milk is coming out from the breast, only when the baby sucks time. So the why the milk is not coming out, it is under the control of the prolactin inhibitory releasing factor. And why it is coming out? Because of the prolactin stimulatory releasing factor. And also dopamine is a clear pharmacological thing. Dopamine also controls the release of the milk, but we are not really much related with the dopamine. Prolactin inhibitory releasing factor actually is a dopamine, nature of the pregnancy is like the dopamine. Now suppose, for example, there is more amount or excess amount of the prolactin is produced in the pregnant. So if more prolactin is produced in the pregnant woman, she will suffer from the high level of the prolactin in the blood, and this is called hyperprolactinemia. More prominent here is that if there is more prolactin in the non-pregnant woman, or suppose a female who is feeding the baby. So in these cases, if there is more amount of the prolactin, so what will happen? The woman is, she is not pregnant at all, but there is more prolactin is releasing. So from the breast inhale, sticky discharge start coming out. And this is kind of gonorrhea, and this is a typical sign that she is not pregnant, no milk in her body. But this milky discharge that is coming out, it is the indication that the blood prolactin level of this female is non-pregnant woman is increased. And suppose the female is given birth the baby and she is feeding the baby, so she cannot control the release of the milk. So what will happen in this case? All the time, throughout the day and the night, the drops of the milk, persistent release of the milk, start coming out from the breast. So this is again a sign that the female is suffering with a high level of the prolactin. And not only this is the first sign associated with the release of the milk. She also suffers with the abnormal or irregular menstrual period. and ovulation is also disturbed. And if it is the married woman, so she has difficulty in the conceiving for the next pregnancy. So on one hand, inside of the genitalia, all the time there is a persistent release of the milk from the breast. Secondly, the disturbances in ovulation, disturbances in the conceiving or in the second pregnancies, then the menstrual cycle becomes irregular or it becomes disturbed. And a lot of what adheres people on whole body, especially on the face. This is also a very important point here about the prolapse. So why could we a woman come across with a high level of the prolactin? So mostly it is the clinical condition when the tumor is or there is adenoma to the anterior pituitary gland, she suffers with the hyperrelease of the prolactin. Hypothyroidism could be a case if a female is losing large amount of the oral contraceptives, so she can also suffer with the high release of the prolactin. And in the male person, all the time, it is hypothyroidism and the impotency, the erectile dysfunction. You look the prolactin, whenever a case of the impotency comes to you, the first thing is to check the prolactin level. If it is high, the male definitely suffering with the erectile dysfunction. High level of the prolactin. So this point I already told you. The only one more thing that is related to the release of the prolactin in the female, the reflex of the milk coming out when the baby sucks the nipple is another function of the prolactin. Or it makes a reflex in the lactating mother. And this is called the milk ejection reflex. So what happens the moment the baby sucks the nipple? The stimulatory factor is released by the hypothalamus. It comes to the anterior pituitary and the release of the prolactin starts. And this prolactin, when it is started, it comes to the breast and the active secretion of the milk is started by the breast. The milk comes to the alveoli, to the duct, to the nipple, and within 30 seconds to 1 minute, the milk is ejected. So this is the way the prolactin makes the milk ejection reflex. And the release of the prolactin keep on going in the lactating mother up to the next 10 months after the delivery of the baby. And after 10 minutes, slowly and slowly it decreases, and by the end of the 2 years, it is almost stopped. So now the cannot lactate the baby. So this This is the second lecture, and this was about the hormones of the anterior.